Hello students, welcome back to English literature class. I am in the third session of the story A Horse and Two Goats by R.K. Narayan. To recall the earlier part of the story, we are introduced to the village Kritam and also to the protagonist Muni, who is desperately poor. Muni, despite his attempts to charm the shopman by laughing at his jokes, the shopman refuses to allow him to purchase the items on credit. Feeling desperate and dejected, arrives at his favorite spot, an area beside the highway that is the site of an old and grandiose horse statue and a warrior. We get a vivid description of the horse statue and the warrior through R.K. Narayan's words. Now let us see what happens next. Turn to page 56 in your treasure trove textbook. Hope you have a copy of it in front of you for better understanding. Muni sat at the foot of the statue, watching his two goats graze in the arid soil among the cactus and lantana bushes. Now, I think all of you know, Muni is at the foot, at the base of the statue. Which statue? Horse statue. While he was sitting, what was he watching? He was watching his two goats, which was grazing in the arid soil. Arid soil means very dry soil among the cactus and lantana bushes. Cactus, I think you must have seen cactus. These are desert plants which have sharp spines and thick stems. And lantana, lantana means these are evergreen shrubs, you could say. So evergreen bushes were there. So among those bushes, these goats were grazing. He looked at the sun. It had tilted westward, no doubt, but it was not the time yet to go back home. If he went too early, his wife would have no food for him. Also, he must give her time to cool off her temper and feel sympathetic, and then she would scrounge and manage to get some food. Now, he looked at the sun. Why do you think he looked at the sun? To see the progress of the daylight. He did not have a watch to look at the time, isn't it? Like now, how we look at the watch every now and then. Earlier, people did not have this facility. So they had to look at the sun, watching the direction of the sunlight, which indicated time. So he looked at the sun. It had tilted westward, no doubt. So the sun had tilted towards westward, which denotes that it was almost evening. But it was not the time yet to go back home. So he knew it was not the right appropriate time for him to go back home. Why do you think he is thinking like this? Because he very well knew that if he goes early, definitely wife wouldn't have prepared dinner for him. So he must give her some time because she was very furious that morning. So he had to give her some time so that her temper would come down or cool down by evening, and also feel sympathetic towards Muni, feel very pity towards him. And then somehow she would scrounge and manage, somehow she would beg and borrow and somehow manage to prepare dinner for him. So he was waiting for that appropriate time to leave. Moving on to the next para. He noticed now a new sort of vehicle coming down at full speed. It looked like both a motor car and a bus. Now, all of a sudden, he noticed a vehicle which was coming towards him at full speed. How was it to look at? It was not like a motor car either, nor like a bus. It was very new to him. Probably had not seen before. He used to be intrigued by the novelty of such spectacles, but of late work was going on at the source of the river on the mountain, and an assortment of people and traffic went past him, and he took it all casually and described to his wife later in the day everything he saw. So he used to be intrigued. Intrigued, he was always very curious or very, very interested by such novelty. Novelty means by such new things, of such spectacle. Spectacle which arises or which was exciting to him. He was always open to new things he wished he could see. So he was always very curious to see new things. But of late, but recently, what was happening? Because of some work there happening at the base of the river, many people, an assortment of people, that is a variety, different type of people were there, and traffic also was too much. That He couldn't see such new things. Now, today he is seeing something great, he thought. And whatever he saw there, every day he would report that to his wife later in the evening, whatever he saw near this highway. That was his usual routine. Let us see what happens further. Today, while he observed the yellow vehicle coming down, he was wondering how to describe it later to his wife while it sputtered and stopped in front of him. So every day he would report it to his wife, isn't it? Whatever he saw at the highway, he would tell his wife. So today he was wondering how to describe this to his wife, because it was not like a bus nor like a motor car. He didn't know how to explain that, describe that to his wife. So while he was thinking, what happened? The vehicle sputtered and stopped in front of him. Sputtered, there was a very heavy noise reeling in front of him, and the vehicle stopped in front of him. What happens next? A red-faced foreigner who had been driving it got down and went round it, stooping, looking, and poking under the vehicle. Then he straightened himself up, looked at the dashboard, stared in Muni's direction, and approached him. So, a red-faced foreigner. So who got down from the vehicle? A foreigner who was very fair and red. His face was red. So he was driving that vehicle. He got down. Why do you think the vehicle stopped all of a sudden? He also doesn't know. To check what happened to the vehicle, he got down, went around the vehicle, stooping, bending towards the vehicle to see what was wrong, looking, and also he did something poking under the vehicle. Then once again, he straightened up, stood straight, and looked at the dashboard. Dashboard, I think all of you know, in the vehicle, near the driver's seat, opposite to that, you could see that dashboard. And approached Muni, staring toward, looking at Muni, he came towards him. What did he ask? Excuse me, is there a gas station nearby? Or do I have to wait until another car comes? He suddenly looked up at the clay horse and cried, "Marvelous," without completing his sentence. Muni felt he should get up and run away and cursed his age. He could not readily put his limbs into action. Now, I think this red-faced foreigner stopped there because he was running short of a fuel. To inquire regarding the gas station, he gets down and he approaches Muni, isn't it? But when he came to inquire about the gas station, he asked, "Excuse me, is there any gas station nearby?" He was asking. When he was talking about this, all of a sudden he was fascinated by the horse statue and he cries out, "Marvelous, marvelous, amazing, wonderful," with great wonder, with great surprise. He looks at that statue and cries out, "Marvelous." So hearing this, Muni felt he should get up and run away. We don't know why did he feel like this, Muni. He thought he should run away, but cursed his age. He knew he was old. He couldn't run. He could not readily put his limbs into action. He could not put his legs into action. He couldn't run because he knew that his legs wouldn't support him at this age. Now, let us see why Muni wanted to run. The red-faced man wore khaki clothes, evidently a policeman or a soldier. Muni said to himself, "He will chase or shoot if I start running. Some dogs chase only those who run. Oh, Shiva, protect me. I don't know why this man should be after me." So now you got the reason why Muni was running. He was scared, thinking that this man, assuming the man to be a soldier or a policeman, seeing his khaki clothes, he thinks that if I run away from him, probably he will chase or probably he may shoot me. That's why I shouldn't run. I have heard people saying even dogs will chase persons, those who run. Oh, definitely, Shiva, oh God, please protect me. I don't know why this man is after me. Why is he come after me? So you come to know about Muni's character now, children. He is very shy, hesitant type, very timid. His nature is timid, you can say, and also God-fearing. Always he says, "Oh God." Earlier also in the story, we had known that, we had seen that if there was progeny, probably God would bless him. Even now he calls out God, "Oh Shiva, oh Lord, protect me." Now, meanwhile, the foreigner cried, "Marvelous," again nodding his head. He paced around the statue with his eyes fixed on it. Muni sat frozen for a while and then fidgeted and tried to edge away. Now, once again, the foreigner is amazed at the statue and he cries out, "Marvelous," nodding his head. But he paced around, is also moving around the statue with his eyes fixed on it. He is wonderstruck by the beauty of the statue. But Muni is sitting there frozen, sat frozen for a while, sat frozen. He was still without any movement. He was hesitant. He was scared looking at the red-faced foreigner, and then fidgeted, made small movements through. While you're nervous, you make these small movements. This also tells that he was a very shy person and tried to edge away, tried to escape from that place. He was thinking how to run away from that place, slowly sneaking away. Now, the other man suddenly pressed his palms together, smiled and said, "Namaste, how do you do?" Now, all of a sudden, the other man means the red-faced foreigner, suddenly pressed, put his palms together and greeted Muni, saying namaste. He knew in India probably that this was how they would greet each other. So namaste, how do you do? He questioned. So Muni couldn't run away. Let us see what happens next. At which Muni spoke the only English expressions he had learnt: yes, no. Having exhausted his English vocabulary, he started in Tamil. "My name is Muni. These two goats are mine and no one can gainsay it. Though our village is full of slanderers these days, will not hesitate to say that what belongs to a man doesn't belong to him." Now, Muni, I think we all know that he is an illiterate man, an uneducated man. So the only expression he knew in English were only yes or no. Having exhausted his English vocabulary, so he didn't know how to speak. So he thought, "Let me start in Tamil," his native tongue, Tamil. He started telling, "My name is Muni and these two goats belong me and no one can gainsay it. No one can deny it. Nobody can dispute that these two goats are not mine." So he says, "Though our village is full of slanderers, there are villages full of people who spread these false rumors, probably these persons may not hesitate to say that these goats may not belong to me." That is what he means. So let me be very clear, these two goats belong to me and my name is Muni. He says this in Tamil. So let us see what how the foreigner reacts. The foreigner faithfully looked in the direction indicated by Muni's fingers, gazed for a while at the two goats and the rocks, and with a puzzled expression, took out the silver cigarette case and lit a cigarette. Now, the foreigner faithfully looked at the direction. So Muni was showing, pointing his fingers towards those goats, indicating that he is the owner of those two goats. So the foreigner faithfully looked at those goats, and gazed at the two goats for a while and with a puzzled expression. He was surprised, he didn't know what to do. So he didn't probably understand Tamil. So he took out a silver cigarette case and lit a cigarette. So this tells that he was a wealthy man because his cigarette case was made of silver. So suddenly remembering the courtesies of the season, he asked, "Do you smoke?" Muni answered, "Yes, no." Whereupon the red-faced man took a cigarette and gave it to Muni, who received it with surprise, having had no offer of a smoke from anyone for years now. Now, suddenly remembering the courtesies of the season, the red-faced foreigner asked, "Do you smoke?" So it is basic manners, children. While he was smoking, he wanted to offer it. For example, while you're eating, when a friend is next to you and can't you eat without offering her? That is basic manners. So in the same way here, politely asks, courtesies of the seas and basic manners, he asked, do you smoke? So Muni says he didn't know how to react. He just says, mumbled and said, yes, no, yes, no. So the red-faced man, he gave a cigarette to Muni, which Muni took, received it with great surprise. He was surprised to have it because he had not spoken for many years till now. Moving on, he had always wanted to smoke a cigarette. Only once did the shopman give him one on credit, and he remembered how good it had tasted. So this tells that Muni also longed, wished to smoke a cigarette. So once he was given it, he didn't want to let go it, because earlier only once, he remembers only once the shopman had given one on credit, and it was very good. The taste was very good, he felt. The other flicked the lighter open and offered a light to Muni. Muni felt so confused about how to act that he blew on it and put it off. So the foreigner, he opened the lighter and offered the light to Muni to help him to light his cigarette. So Muni didn't know how to react. He was like confused when he was offered this light. He just blew the light from the lighter off. That is how he reacted. He was very confused. The other, puzzled but undaunted, flourished his lighter, presented it again, and lit Muni's cigarette. So the red-faced foreigner, he was quite surprised but undaunted. He was not afraid, flourished his lighter. Once again, he offered the lighter to and lit Muni's cigarette. Muni drew a deep puff and started coughing. It was racking, no doubt, but extremely pleasant. So Muni started enjoying this smoke. Muni drew a deep puff. That is how they smoke, isn't it? Inhaling it and exhaling it. So Muni drew a deep puff and started coughing. Once it entered his throat and lungs, probably he started coughing. It was racking. It was very bad. Painful probably for a while, no doubt, but extremely pleasant. But it was very good. When his cough subsided, he wiped his eyes and took stock of the situation, understanding the other man was not an inquisitor of any kind. Now, Muni, when his cough reduced, came down, he started wiping his eyes and took stock of the situation, slowly, gradually understood the situation. Carefully, he understood about that situation and came to know that the other man, the foreigner, was not an inquisitor of any kind. Inquisitor is a person who makes an inquiry. So he came to know that this person is not a policeman or a soldier who's not making any inquiry. So, yet, in order to make sure, he remained wary. So in order to make sure whether he is a policeman or a soldier, he was very careful. He remained calm and cautious. No need to run away from a man who gave him such a potent smoke. His head was reeling from the effect of one of those strong American cigarettes made with roasted tobacco. The man said, I come from New York, took out a wallet from his hip pocket and presented his card. So, in order to make sure, he remained very careful. Like, no need to run away. He came to a conclusion that he need not run away from a man who was so kind enough, so polite, that he offered him a potent smoke, a cigar which had a potent smoke, which was very, very strong. His head was reeling from the effect of one of those. So he was still enjoying that he didn't come out of that enjoyment of that cigarette, you could say. His head was reeling from the effect of one of those strong American cigarettes made of roasted tobacco. So the foreigner said, I come from New York, and he took out a wallet and probably showed his visiting card, probably, or presented his card. Moving on with the next para, Muni shrank away from the card. Perhaps he was trying to present a warrant and arrest him. Beware of Kaki, one part of his mind warned. Take all the cigarettes or whatever is offered, but don't get caught. Beware of Kaki. He wished he were in 70 as the shopman had said. At 70, one didn't run, but surrendered to whatever came. Now, Muni shrank away from the car. Shrank away? He didn't know how to react as soon as the red-faced man showed him this card, visiting card. Thinking the card, he mistook the card to be some warrant. Probably he is a police, he thought. He was trying to arrest me. So one part of his mind is saying, beware, be careful of this khaki. And if you are running away, take all the cigarettes or whatever is offered, but don't get caught. Just run away, taking away or snatching all the cigarettes. Anyway, be careful with this khaki. Beware of khaki. He wished now he weren't 70. Now he knew that his age was 70. So now he thought that I shouldn't have been 70. Otherwise, I could have run away from this place. At 70, one didn't run, but surrendered to whatever came. So at the age of 70, I don't think anyone can run, but surrender to whatever came. So I had to accept that circumstance and that situation. He could only ward off trouble by talk. So he went on all in chase Tamil, for which Kritam was famous. So he could only ward off trouble by talk. So now whatever trouble he had, whatever problem he had, he could only ward off. He could only avoid this by only sorting out through talk. So he went on. So he started to sort out this trouble with Chase Tamil, pure Tamil, for which Kritam was very famous for pure Tamil. So he started in Tamil, started speaking in Tamil. What did he say? He said, before God, Sir Bhagwan, who sees everything, I tell you, sir, that we know nothing of the case. If the murder was committed, whoever did it will not escape. Bhagwan is all seeing. Don't ask me about it. I know nothing. So he says, before God, in front of God, who is seeing everything, we all are equal. So I tell you, sir, if such murder was committed, definitely we have no escape. Nobody can escape from God because God is always watching above us. Don't ask me about it. Don't ask me regarding that murder. I know nothing. I don't know anything regarding that murder. A body had been found mutilated and thrown under a tamarind tree at the border between Kritam and Kuppam few weeks before, giving rise to much gossip and speculation. Muni added an explanation. Anything is possible there. People over there will stop at nothing. The foreigner nodded his head and listened courteously, though he understood nothing. So he continues, he says, probably Muni had heard regarding a murder. A body, that is a dead body, had been found mutilated. It was disfigured and thrown under a tamarind tree at the border between two villages, that is Kritam and Kuppam. Between these two villages, probably there was a tamarind tree. So this body, which was disfigured, mutilated, was thrown there. So that was the gossip which was going on in the village. To much gossip and speculation, this was the guesswork by these people. Muni again continued saying, anything is possible there. Possible there in the other village. People over there will stop at nothing. That is, they spread these rumors, false rumors everywhere. The foreigner nodded. So this foreigner did not understood a word about whatever Muni spoke. He just listened courteously. Courteously, that's politely. Manners, that is manners, isn't it? While the other person is talking, you shouldn't be interrupting him. So he was just listening, though he understood nothing. Moving on. I am sure you know when this horse was made, asked the red man ingratiatingly. Now, I'm sure you know regarding this horse. Can you tell me when this horse was made? He is asking, the red man, the foreigner is asking Muni ingratiatingly, means intending to gain approval of Muni. Muni reacted to the relaxed atmosphere by smiling himself and pleaded, please go away, sir. I know nothing. I promise we will hold him for you if we see any bad character around, and we will bury him up to his neck in a coconut pit if he tries to escape. But a village has always had a clean record. Must definitely be the other village. So while the red-faced foreigner is talking about the horse statue, Muni is talking about the murder which took place recently. So now he's saying, now please go away, sir. I do not know anything regarding the murder, but I promise if I find any person who is suspicious or who is guilty, definitely we will see to it that he'll be buried up to his neck in a coconut. He will be punished. We will see that he is punished. He will not have any escape because our village has a clean record. I don't think anybody from my village would have done this. It must be definitely from the other village, he says. Continuing, now the red man implored, please, please, I will speak slowly. Please try to understand me. Can't you understand even a simple word of English? Everyone in this country seems to know English. I've gotten along with English everywhere in this country, but you don't speak it. Have you any religious or spiritual scruples against English speech? Now, they both are conversing. Now, language is to communicate, to convey the messages. But here, what is happening? It has become a barrier. Whatever Muni is speaking, the foreigner is unable to understand. And what foreigner wants to convey, Muni is not understanding a bit. Language has become a barrier here. Now, the red man, the foreigner, implored his pleading. Please, I will speak slowly. I will speak slowly in English so that you can understand. So probably he had been on a trip in India. Wherever he had been, he had met people who spoke in English. But here, Muni, who is uneducated, illiterate, he couldn't follow whatever the foreigner spoke. So he's saying, everyone in this country, that is in India, seems to know English. According to the foreigner, he thought that everybody knew English. So everyone in this country seems to know English. I have gotten along with English everywhere in this country, but you don't speak it. Have you any religious or spiritual scruples against English speech? Do you have any religious or spiritual objection against speaking English? That is what he questions. Now, moving on. Muni made some indistinct sounds in his throat and shook his head. So Muni made some unclear sounds. He himself didn't know what to do. He shook his head. Encouraged, the other went on to speak at length, uttering each syllable with care and deliberation. Now, looking at Muni, probably he thought that Muni is understanding whatever he is speaking. So, very clearly, he started speaking, uttering each word with care and deliberately he started speaking. Presently, he sidled over and took a seat beside the old man, explaining, "You see, last August, we probably had the hottest summer in history, and I was working in short sleeves in my office on the 40th floor of the Empire State Building." Now he is talking about what had happened earlier in August. Presently, he sidled, he just sneaked or crept over and took a seat next to the old man, that is Muni, started explaining to him, in August, they had the summer which was very, very hot. And I was working in short sleeves. Short sleeves means he was dressed informally without any jacket over. Usually they wear a coat or jacket in the Westerners. So because it was extremely hot, he was working in short sleeves in his office, which was on top, that is 40th floor on Empire State Building. 40th floor of the Empire State Building. They had a power failure one day, you know. And there I was stuck for 4 hours, no elevator, no air conditioning. All the way in train, I kept thinking. And the minute I reached home in Connecticut, I told my wife, Ruth, we will visit India this winter. It's time to look at other civilizations. Now, he says, this is what happened once when there was a power cut, you know. And there I was stuck in the lift probably. He was stuck there since there was power cut. He was stuck there for 4 hours without any lift, elevator, and no air conditioning. So they couldn't even tolerate this power cut for 4 hours. All the way in the train while coming back home, he was thinking regarding this power cut. And when he came back home in Connecticut, Connecticut is an area in New York, he told his wife, "We will visit India this winter. It is time to look at other civilizations, other human societies. Let us also have a look." So as soon as he told this, next day, she called the travel agent first thing and told him to fix it. And so here I am. So the next day itself, the following day, the foreigner's wife spoke to the travel agent first thing, very first on the next day. That is what she did and told him to fix it, the visit regarding India visit. And so here I am. This is how I am here. Ruth came with me, but is staying back at Srinagar, and I am the one doing the rounds and joining her later. So even Ruth, my wife, also has joined me. But what has happened is she is staying at Srinagar, and I am doing the rounds. I am moving around here, and I will be joining her later. So this is where I'm going to stop today, children. I will be continuing the story in my next class. Hope you have understood till now. Thank you.